Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. A very warm welcome from Darul Ummah in Shadwell, London. Sheikh, assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillah, barakallah.
I was going to attempt to shake my head, but inshallah.
Inshallah, soon.
Allah make it easy. So we are here in Darul Ummah to talk about Ramadan. Do you know Ramadan is coming just in your doorstep? Subhanallah. Ramadan is here, my brothers and sisters, those of you who are watching right now. And we are so blessed to have Ramadan. But for me, it's completely different for three reasons. One is, I feel strange. I can't believe that Ramadan is here for me because I work for a charity and every year I don't get to stay at home. I always complain. Oh, I don't get the time to have iftar at my home with my kids, with my relatives. But I'm scared that I complained all this time. But subhanallah, Allah has given that time and the opportunity. I'm scared. How am I going to spend that time? Will I be just? Will I be able to make my Creator happy as I complain? And this is why I decided to sit down with the Sheikh today to gain some knowledge and then share with you, inshallah, so that you might want to gain some knowledge through our discussion, inshallah. So Sheikh, as I said, it's a very strange, scary thing for me. Tell me very briefly about your feeling.
Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, wa salatu wassalamu ala nabiyyina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. This is very, I think it's a shared feeling, you know, everyone.
Yes.
It's a very unique time. A very strange time, and I think this, as we get closer to Ramadan, it's that strangeness is even becoming more apparent, because we normally have an image of how Ramadan works, you know, things happen in a particular way. Now that it's happening this time with all of these changes, I think we're all very shocked and very surprised and taken aback. But I think as Muslims and as, you know, people of faith, we have alhamdulillah, and we are fortunate. We have direction. We know that Allah Azza wa Jalla is doing this for a reason. We have our Lord to resort to return to cry to ask for our help, to ask for any help that we need. So all of this is, I think, is very comforting for us as believers. So with this strangeness and sadness, I think we can definitely put our trust in Allah that Allah is not going to make us go through this knowing that we'll fail. Inshallah, Allah will give us an opportunity to pass, inshallah.
Inshallah, Allah make it easy for us. Ameen. We say Ameen. So, for one, how should we spend this Ramadan then?
I think this Ramadan should be spent as Ramadans ought to be spent anyway. Because the whole purpose of Ramadan, as Allah clearly states in His Quran, the hikmah of Ramadan is to attain taqwa. And taqwa is, to explain it, it's to be conscious, to be cautious, to be scared of Allah, to save oneself from Jahannam. And so if you look at conscious and cautious and save oneself from Jahannam, we see that this taqwa is supposed to have an effect on us physically, psychologically, and spiritually too. So this Quran and this Ramadan, they come together as a package. In fact, the speciality of Ramadan is through the Quran. And so the hikmah of Ramadan is that we become closer to Allah. We become more conscious of Allah, more cautious of Allah, more closer to Allah. How does that happen? That happens by, first of all, this fasting puts us in a continuous state of ibadah for many hours of the day. There aren't many other ibadat or any other ibadat that do the same sort of effect. So for 18 hours or 16 hours, in one stretch, you are in a continuous state of ibadah, which, for example, in salah, you're supposed to be focused for 10 minutes, 15 minutes. But in siyam, you're supposed to be focused throughout, because the hadith teach you that just like, you know, you will stop eating and drinking, you must also stop sinning.
Absolutely.
Scholars say you must also even stop thinking about sins too. So this is building into us this consciousness, cautiousness, aware of Allah, you know, careful that I don't want to commit any sins. And that can last with us for the rest of Ramadan and also the rest of the year. So how should we practice Ramadan this year? We should try to make, I think that's quite a big question as well, but to try and achieve this goal of taqwa.
Okay, let's break it.
Yeah, let's break it down. Yeah.
Ramadan is the month of Quran, subhanallah. Quran came to us, that's why we Muslims are so special. Quran came to Jibreel, that's why he's so special. Quran came in the night of Ramadan, that's why the night is special. So let's talk about Quran then. So how do I get to know Quran in Ramadan?
Yes.
What shall I do?
Yes. The Quran is something, you know, is supposed to be, first of all, recited.
Okay.
So reciting the Quran, whether you understand it or not, you get so much reward for it anyway. For every letter, you get 10 hasanat.
Okay.
Okay. And for the one who recites the Quran in a skillful way, his station is with the honorable angels of Allah. And as for the one who struggles, he gets two rewards per letter, meaning twice the one hasana for his reading and one hasana for his struggling. Subhanallah. So the Quran is supposed to be recited. It's supposed to be understood.
Absolutely.
Yeah, but this is something that we need to really work on, try to understand the Quran. And alhamdulillah, now we've got so many options. We can read a tafsir or a translation or an explanation, or we can listen to, or we can watch videos of people like, you know, so many scholars out there, Shaykh Noman Ali Khan, Dr. Yasir Qadi, various other mashayikh, our own British Shaykh Abdul Hakim Murad, where he explains various principles of our deen. But generally for Quran, there are, you know, specific scholars. To understand the Quran through these tafasir is very important, to recite the Quran, to understand the Quran, to practice the Quran. So ilm is knowledge and amal is action. So ilm and amal are connected. If you don't do amal of the ilm, then it doesn't fulfill the combination.
Okay.
So we've got to practice what we learn. And that's why, you know, we hear the story that Umar radiallahu anhu, it took a long time for him to memorize Surah Al-Baqarah. But the reality of it is that he was memorizing and practicing at the same time. So it wasn't just about collecting the Quran in our mind, but it's also about practicing it, right? So practicing, and also fourthly, to propagate, to teach it. And you start with your nearest of kin, your family, your wife, your husband, your children, your mom, your dad, whoever is closest to you, you teach them also some one or two ayat, how to read it, how to understand it, how to practice it. That's one of the easiest ways, or these are some of the key ways to connect with the Quran.
Thank you so much. Remember, I started by saying I'm scared, that I complain, that I don't have enough time. Now is the time that either you're working from home or you are not working, is for you to do extra bit, to either to, if you don't know the surah, make a target that I want to learn one surah at least this Ramadan, or I want to understand one surah, inshallah. Okay, so we talk about Quran, we talk about Ramadan. Now, many of you scholars saying we should do whatever way we can, the mosque is closed, make our house a mosque, pray in Jama'ah. So if I want to pray Taraweeh with my kids, with my parents, how do I do that?
Yeah. So alhamdulillah, even before Taraweeh, we've said the same thing for Farad Salah as well.
Yes.
Farad Salah, five Salahs, you should try to establish the Adhan, that's
absolutely
a Sunnah.
Yes.
The Iqama is also a Sunnah. And then to do a Jama'ah at home, with your wife, with your kids. So the Taraweeh Salah is like any other Salah in terms of its format. You do your Thana and your Fatiha and your Surah. It's in two rakat cycles, and you should do 20 rakats. That's the, you know, ongoing Sunnah from the time of Sayyidina, you know, the Sahaba, the earliest of Sahaba, and until now in Haramain Sharifain. That's the normal, that's the Sunnah, the preferred Sunnah, to do 20 rakats.
Right.
So what you would do is, you can do it individually, but if you're at home, you could do it as a Jama'ah. And if you're leading, You would lead like Fajr Salah.
Okay.
You know how loud prayer. Loud. You've been to Taraweeh before, so you know how it works.
Okay.
So you can recite the surahs that you know.
Okay. But what if I want to have the Quran in my hand? I want to make it longer. I want to ponder, and so that I can remember me leading Salah, Quran in my hand. My kids are behind. So that in the Day of Judgment, Allah knows. That can be an avenue for me to enter Jannah. Am I allowed to do that?
So the question is, can I have a mushaf in front of me?
Yeah.
As for holding a Quran in your hand, this is not recommendable. You shouldn't do that.
Okay.
However, if you wanted to look into the mushaf, there is some leeway for that, which means that you have a mushaf open in front of you, but you don't touch it too often.
Okay.
So once or twice you turn the page, but you shouldn't go beyond that.
Okay.
It is, there is some debate even within the Hanafi school of law.
Okay.
Imam Hanifa rahimahullah, he would not allow it. His students were okay, but they still said it's makruh. And there are, you know, sort of leeways in other schools of law as well. So because of this excessive time of need and desperation, and I completely understand that you'd want to recite the Quran longer, and it's not nice to just recite Surah Al-Ikhlas again and again.
Yes.
So if you wanted to have a mushaf, this is how you do it. Have a mushaf in front of you on a stand or something, which is on your eye level, and you can easily reach for turning the page. You shouldn't hold the Quran in your hand, because that turns into amal kathir, too much action.
Okay.
And that's outside of salah, and that can invalidate your salah.
Okay.
Okay. In any case, you should have the mushaf in front of you, and then you can look at the mushaf. And this is obviously because it's nafal salah, sunnah salah, which is because of this is allowed. If it's in fard salah, it wouldn't be allowed.
No. Yeah. Yes.
So in Taraweeh we can. This is actually it is an allowable option that one can consider. And I don't think even if according to some of the ulama it is not considered to be allowed, I think it's a time to look into. At times of darura and necessity, even our own schools of law allow for us to borrow opinions from others. Okay. And so it should be okay, inshallah, if you wanted to look into a mus'haf. Okay. But with the conditions that you don't touch the mus'haf too many times and it's there on a stand and you're just looking at it.
Right, okay. So that's good, amazing. I hope you understood very clearly, and I hope you will take some action to get your kids, get your family together to, you know, because mosque is closed, you lead, and this is where you show the leadership as a father, that I've been leading all this time. Today, in the path of Allah, I want to lead. And then when I'm gone, my children can lead, inshallah. So whatever, as a family, so, since the lockdown started, everybody talk about family, get together, do things. But Ramadan, you are tired, you don't have food in your stomach. As a parent, as a people in the house, how do we go about? What do we do? Well, how to make it easy?
Yeah, with regards to, especially for children, because this is as challenging for them, maybe even more, as it is for us, because they normally go to school, they see their friends, their cousin on the weekend, but now they're trapped at home with you. So just like you're probably getting tired of seeing them all the time, they're probably getting more tired of seeing you even before that, because they have less patience anyway. So it's really, really important to realize, first of all, that we're in this together. That, you know, we're all experiencing this lockdown and this Ramadan together. It's for everyone. So then that puts us on the same level as our children, and we can sympathize with that as well. Number two, this whole Ramadan, whether it's more difficult or not, we need to realize what we're doing it for.
Okay.
If we, the sooner we realize that it's for the sake of Allah only, wallah, everything becomes a lot easier. That I'm doing it for the sake of my Allah. So even if it's difficult, I will bear patiently.
Right.
Even if it means my kids are shouting at me, and they're getting angry with me, and I just control myself, I don't get angry back. That's for the sake of Allah. Then Allah will reward you even for that as well. Okay. See, that for that. So that's obviously in terms of the mentality. But as for managing and planning the time, I think we have to be creative. It's very important to be creative. So from now, talk to your kids that Ramadan is coming. You know,
make your plan.
Yeah, make, you know, dad and mom's going to be very tired and hungry. So let's make an action plan. How we do things. And I just want to share with you. My wife made a really, really nice plan today. She went and bought this this basket thing that she's hanging on the door.
Okay.
And she told my son that because I'm going to be so tired, I can't give you new works every time. So I will leave you a set of tasks in the basket.
And whatever he picks up, and that's
you pick up, and you come back and you get new one. And once you finish all of your tasks, there'll be a treat inside it for you. Drink or sweet or crisp, you can have that. So that's something you can maybe consider,
Amazing. Okay. Yeah. And absolutely what Sheikh said, we are all in this together. We need to help each other. We need to get the kids to help the mom and the brothers that are watching. You need to help your parents, help your wife. Not just... just before iftar, the sisters are in the kitchen and you making dua. No, we all want to go to Jannah together, not leaving the sisters behind. I want to finish by asking you this question. What about last 10 days? How, because we are home, we are already bored, what will be your recommendation?
First of all, you're allowed to do i'tikaf at home anyway.
Okay.
That's inshallah. Already permitted. You can do i'tikaf at home, especially for the women, they can do i'tikaf at home. So you can allocate yourself a particular space and then you can say, I will restrict myself here for ibadah and etc. That's allowed. But of course, the main important thing is to search for Laylatul Qadr.
Okay.
And I think as we go through Ramadan, our spiritual sort of strength should increase. So we should be able to stand for longer in the night. We should be able to read more Quran. We should be able to become more patient, more used to fasting. So then when the last 10 days come, as the Prophet ﷺ used to, he used to go work even harder. He used to wake up his family in tahajjud time, in Qiyam al-Layl, and they used to all pray together. This is how we should plan for the last 10 days. There's still some more time left. Maybe we can speak again in detail about the last
10 days. We will, inshallah.
Inshallah. Yes. But I think we should prepare for that from now, that my Ramadan shouldn't be that first few days, alhamdulillah, I'm super pious, and then third, fourth day, or tenth day, you know, I leave all my actions. Let's have a plan. Consistently, we increase. And by the end of Ramadan, we're better than we started off in the beginning of Ramadan. That should be the plan.
Jazakallah khair. You see, we briefly talked about Ramadan, but in the future, in next few days, we will talk about Ramadan. But there's something else I would like to ask you. what did you think about the video? Did you really like it? I'm sure you did. But then again, to carry out the service from Darul Ummah, we need your support. It's a dawah that we are trying to spread to the whole humanity. Inshallah, we will together to spread the word. But don't forget, it's up to you either you want to be with us or not. Either you want to be part of this legacy or not. Either you, this pandemic is can be somewhere. Some people are saying it's a blessing. It's how you take it. So my brothers and sisters, please do share the video. And if you want to support, there will be a link at the bottom when the video finish. Please try to click the link, inshallah, and support whatever you, whatever way you can. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bring goodness to us and you, and we say Ameen, inshallah.
Ameen. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.